Christ and be glad in it as we stand wherever we are. Let us lift our voices and praise God from all blessings. Thank you. into our automobiles, into our are right now, God, because we know that where your presence is, there is peace. Where your presence is, there is joy. Where your presence is, there is love. Where your presence is, God, everything is there we need, God. We invite you in right now, God, to have your way, God. Move by your spirit right now, God. For somebody needs a touch from you, oh God. Move right now, Father. Touch hearts. Touch minds. Touch spirits right now, God. For in times like these, we need to feel you, God. Somebody needs to know that you are real. Somebody is at the end of their rope, God. And they need to know that you will pick them up and pull them back through. God, somebody is so far down, they don't know where to go, God, but they need to know that you are the way, the truth, and the life, oh God. Move by your spirit, touch us, oh God. Bless us and open our hearts and minds to hear a word from you, oh God. Bless this Union Bethel Church family, God, that it may be the church that you would have us to be. Bless the woman of God who is going to stand behind your sacred desk and rightly divide the word of truth, God. Anoint the musicians to be able to sing your pleasures and songs of praise, God. We just glorify you.
Oh, yes.
We give you all that we have. But we know that it's in you that we live and in you that we move, and it's in you that we have our being, oh God. We surrender ourselves unto you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Thank you.
grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let us use them, if prophecy, in proportion to our faith, if service, in our serving, the one who teaches, in his teaching, the one who exhorts, in his exhortation, the one who contributes, in generosity, the one who leads, with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. It got so good, I got to finish it off. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will keep burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. I read Romans 12. Chapter 12, verses 3, and I jumped from 16 all the way down to 21. I got to say 21 again. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. From all that dwell below the skies.
Rich, she loves to have a
pastor sing before she preaches.
Oh, yes.
So I'm going to attempt to do one of my favorite numbers. A lot of times we look around and we see how those people who are, we know are not doing the right thing, but it seems like they are. Got so much more than we have. We still over here struggling and trying to do right, but they, you know, live and rise and rise and do whatever they want to do. But the word God, this song, it always comes to my mind when I think about that, and that's that follow along, we'll know all about it. It's not for us to know right now. We just got to keep trusting in the Lord. It's going to be all right. Can we slow that down a little bit? Let me see.
We'll understand it.
Father, give me You, me, everybody. You see, regardless of our views of the church, as Christ followers, we are connected to the church. We are one body in Christ. You see, we don't lose our individuality, but we are inseparably connected to other Christians. Now, we may differ in our race, in our background, in our gender, and so forth on, but we are all one in Christ, which means he don't look at the color of our skin. It doesn't matter who you are, because we all are one. He doesn't look at us different, because we're one. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman, or what you are, because we all are one in the body of Christ. You see, Romans 4:5 says, our body illustrates how we are one in the church. Different parts of our body looks different and do different things, but every part make up who we are. Mm-hmm. Every part of your body make up who you are, who I am. You see, we are one body made of different, unique, and amazing parts. Mm-hmm. If you didn't know that this morning, I'm telling you, we are one body. You are different. You are unique. And you have some amazing parts. You see, our body parts can't be changed. They remain the parts of our bodies. The same is true for the church. Paul said like this, we are not only individually connected to Christ, but we are individually members of one another. We need each other and belong to each other. Christ formed this church. We need each other in order for the church to function as a healthy body. Let me say that again. We need each other in order for the church to function as a healthy body.
Amen.
You see, I remember growing up and as kids, you know, we had those little children's songs. But even as a adult, I can remember singing this song. And the song said, he's all over me, and he's keeping me alive. You see, I know he is keeping me alive. And it goes on and says, he's in my hand, he's in my feet, I can hardly keep my seat. And it says, he's in my spirit and my soul, and I'll never grow old. It says, he's in my heart, he's in my mind, and I'm glad that he's mine. I know he is keeping me alive. You see, we are the body. And that song was just really telling us that God is all over. He's in our head and in our feet. You see, as children, they teach us that. But as adults, sometimes we forget about that. So when you raise your hand up, remember that God is in your hands. He's in your feet and he's in your soul until the day that you grow old. Now, the second reason is we have gifts to support each other. We have gifts, not just me and you, but I tell you, we all have different gifts that we can offer and support each other. We need each other to grow, flourish, and become everything God has called us to be. God gives believers different gifts so he can help and support each other, so we can help and support each other. We often refer to these gifts as spiritual gifts. But when we are saved, each of us becomes a member of the body of Christ and is given a unique gifting that we are to use for the purpose of helping the body of Christ. Listen, we all have a gift. Whether your gift is to sing, to minister, whatever your gift is, we all have a gift.
Amen.
In Romans 12:6-8, Paul only talks about some of the gifts. And he says, prophecy, service, teaching, exhorting, giving. Leading, showing mercy, that isn't a complete list of gifts, but he just only named a few. Paul also referred gifts in 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians 4:11, and each list is different. He said, we are to do that which is is obvious to us and which we feel compelled and capable of doing. Some people may have different feelings about the gifts, and they may feel a certain way. But you know, sometimes us as human, we have the tendency to think somebody's gifts is more important than the other. Mm-hmm. But that's not true. That's not true. That's not what God wants us. You see, there are far too many Christians believe that they don't play a part role in the kingdom of God. They think to themselves, I'm not the pastor. I'm not the worship leader or minister. Or I'm not the missionary. So I'm not that important. That's the idea that we deprive from. And this message in Paul in Ephesians 4, Paul says that from him the whole body fit and knitted together by every supporting ligament promotes the growth of the body for building up itself in the love by the proper working of each individual part. You play a part in the church. You may think your part is small, but it's not. Brother Craig plays part with the music.
Yes.
And then we got Brother James, he videos. So everybody play a part in here. You see, it bears repeating the whole body, promoting the work of the body. We are each part of the whole body, regardless of our spiritual gifts. We each are critical to the life of the ministry of the body of Christ. You see, the church does not function and grow only because preachers preach and teach. Let me say that again. The church does not function and grow only because preachers preach and teachers teach. Stop thinking that you don't play a part in the body of Christ.
Right.
We all have a part. We can't just put it on one person. That's too much because the church cannot function healthy. You see, the body grows as each one of us uses the gift of God graciously gave us. The church can't reach its full potential until all individual parts is used in the gift of God has given them for the good work of the body. As I think about the theme of the church, it says, together we are better. Not together, the past is better. It says, together we
Amen.
Are better.
Amen.
We are the church. Amen. I know that it feels like because we're not in a building, but we still are the church. You're in the church right now in your homes. Whether you're on your phone or you're driving in your car, together we are better. And the song says, as I think about it, it says, the chimes of time brings out the news, another day too. Someone slipped and fell, was that someone you? You may have known for added strength, your courage to renew. Do not be disheartened, for I have news for you. It is no secret. Let me tell you this again. You see, it's no secret what God can do. You see, what he did for others, he'll do it for you. When his arms wide open, calling you, it's no secret what God can do. So stop worrying about other people and their gifts. Just give your all to God. Because you are the body of Christ. And it starts today. And you see, the third reason is that we are to love and serve together. Not one person, but he said together. In verse 12, Paul gave us the secret ingredients that enable the body of Christ to grow, to thrive, and become the healthiest version itself of love. This is a Greek word, agape, a word that expresses the essential nature of God. This is not a term that describes emotion. It's a word about how we act. We are not called to have just warm and fuzzy feelings about the church. Rather, we are to love the church by serving her with our hearts and with our souls and with our minds. You see, we act with a love infused, all commitment. We're all into one. You see, Paul gave us another example. He says, it's like a picture with a sacrificial look of love look like. The verses point out the actions of some love. Consider how we ought to carry out these actions with Christian love. Don't be lazy. Don't be be flurried, which means don't be passionate. Serve, rejoice, and be patient. And pray. Amen. You got to pray. Constantly. You got to pray. You got to worship. You got to contribute, which means you got to give. You got to show hospitality. You got to be friendly, and you got to be blessed.
Right.
Let me say that. You got to be friendly. You got to welcome those in. You got to be blessed, and you got to pray. You see, weep with those that weep, live in harmony and agreement, and don't be harsh. Don't think of yourself too high. This is what love looks like. What a beautiful picture it is. Surely everyone among us wants to be part of the church, full of members like that. But this beautiful picture of what the church is to begin with you and me. It begins with you and me. We have to start from somewhere. It don't matter if you have one member to 1,000 members. It begins with you and me.
Amen.
It begins with the leader. We lead by example. Why should we love and serve the church in a sacrificial way? Because that is exactly how Jesus Christ loved us.
Amen.
Jesus didn't just sit back in heaven and fold his arm and tell us to get our act together before he would love us. Despite of all our failings and our shortcomings, he left the glory of heaven and put on our broken, and he left the glory of heaven and put on our broken flesh. Right? And then he came to this planet for one reason. And that reason is to love you and to love me. You see, God provides us his own love for us in that while we were yet sinners. You see, while we were yet sinners, he didn't say me or the past, he said we. But while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Remember to commit to the church. We must have a devoted heart. We must listen. And we must keep praying and don't worry.
Right.
Because if we worry, all that is in vain. You see, as I come to a close, the other day my boss was singing this old song, and I like it. And each week I have a different song that inspires me. I'm not going to sing it, I'm just going to sing the words. And this song almost reminds me of my grandmother, because her favorite song was Psalms 91. And the song says, "In thee, O Lord, I put my trust. And on your name, Lord, on your name I will call, and you will answer and deliver me out of the hands of my enemies." It says, 1,000 shall fall at my side, 10,000 at my right hand, but no evil shall come nigh my dwelling. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide. Under the shadows of the Almighty shall abide in the presence of God. He shall abide.
Amen.
You see, we have to learn how to commit to the church and show that we love God. We need to learn how to reach our hand out and help somebody. Have you done this week? I know we got social distance going on, but have you thought about your commitment? You see, I don't know about you, but we're living in the last of the last days. We have been through everything you can think of in 2020. We have been through death. We have been through hurricanes. We have been through it all.
Right.
Yet we still stand.
That's right.
If you look at yourself in the mirror and say, you survived it. So many people didn't make it, but you woke up this morning to hear my voice.
That's right.
You got to be committed to the church, because it's time. I'm tired of preaching over our young men that are dead in the street. You parents, you get out there with these young men and you tell them how God loves them. You show them that you love them. Stop turning up your nose to these young men that's on the corner. We got to commit to the church. We got to go to the streets. We're going to mess up. Because we call it
our
love.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
What an awesome word.
Amen.
We got to examine ourselves and see if we are. spiritually committed as we are? Are we as committed to God as God is to us? That's the thought that I want to leave you with on today. As we move into our invitational period, are you as committed to God as He is committed to you? Mm-hmm. Are you as committed to His church as He has committed Himself to you? Remember Rick said it well. He said he'd been through everything you can think of this year. But
right.
For some reason, we're still here.
Amen.
We're still standing, kept by mercy and grace. I'm still here.
Amen.
I'm still here. I'm still here. Amen. There may be one today who does not know who Jesus is and the pardoning of his sins. We offer him to you on today. He will pick you up. He will dust you off. He will clean you up. He will give you everything that you need. If that is you, we offer him unto you. All you have to do is surrender yourself unto him. There's an old hymn that says, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. If that is you, wherever you are, I just want you to lift up your hands and say, Father, I've sinned. I've fallen short. I ask that you would forgive me now. Take me in. I want to live right. And I know that I can't do it without you. I believe that you died on the cross. I believe that you rose on that third day and you sit now on the right hand of the Father God. Please cleanse me, wash me, fill me with your Holy Spirit. And I will ever give you praise. From this day forth and forevermore, in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
And just like that,
amen.
You are saved.
Amen.
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 Why don't you lift your voices and sing the hymn, oh, all to Jesus. All to Jesus. I surrender. Surrender all. Oh, I surrender.